Our next speaker is Constanza Camargo. I've had the really great pleasure of being able to work with her on numbers of occasions. If you ever want to get 1,000 great ideas out of a person in a very short time, she's the person to talk to because she is so creative and has such wonderful ideas, especially about disease prevention and how we could make the maximum impact on populations. So it's really great to have her here, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Julie, for the kind introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. It's really a pleasure to be here with all of you. I want to thank and congratulate Juha and Robert for the successful summit. Today, I will be presenting about the changing epidemiology of gastric cancer. This figure represents the incident rates of gastric cancer over time for different populations. And as you can see, there has been a dramatic decline in the rates for the last 4 decades. And I think that this is one of the reasons why gastric cancer lost interest. This reduction in the rates is mainly due to the impact of sanitation, refrigeration, and the wide use of antibiotics. We know already that in the US we have the heterogeneity in the rates of gastric cancer, with non-Hispanic whites having the lowest rates across all racial ethnic groups. In general, gastric cancer is a male predominance disease, and this is a representation of incidence in several populations. And as you can see, in all of them, we see a twofold difference between males and females, and this sex difference is not explained by the well-known risk factors, H. pylori infection, and particularly smoking. So this argues towards a biological effect. In anatomical terms, gastric cancer is divided into subtypes: cardiac cancer, which represents the tumors localized to the more proximal area of the stomach, and non-cardia, which group the tumors localized in other areas of the stomach. Globally, non-cardiac gastric cancer is the more predominant type and is associated with H. pylori, positively associated. Cardiac cancer is not associated with H. pylori, with the exception of the endemic areas of cardiac cancer in Asia. H. pylori prevalence have been declining over time, and these are data from the two national surveys in the US, ENHANCE for the early 90s, ENHANCE 3, and ENHANCE 4 for the late, 80s for the ENHANCE 3, and 90s for the ENHANCE 4. And as you can see, if you focus on the cohort 1925, the prevalence in the early 80s was 50%, and in the early 90s it was about 40%. We have seen a decline in the exposure. There is a cohort effect, so new generations are not being exposed to the infection. I'm going to summarize the results of our more recent trend analysis in the intramural program. We also follow incident rates for gastric cancer as part of our gastric cancer portfolio. For this analysis, we use all the C registries, the 18 registries in the US, plus the CDC registries. Combining this analysis, we have 80% of the registries in the United States. To your left, we have a representation of the cohort rate ratios. If we take the birth cohort of 1955 and we compare other cohorts, we see that for people born in 1910 and people born after that up to 1950, we saw a dramatic decline in the risk of gastric cancer. But unfortunately, we are going to see a concerning trend of increased risk of gastric cancer after 1950. To complement these findings, to your right, we have the age-specific rates, and please focus on the bottom, the younger groups. And as you can see, for both male and females, we see a significant increase in the risk of gastric cancer. The confidence intervals are wide because the numbers are small, but this is particularly seen for females. In this figure, I have the stratification by anatomical subsite, non-cardia first, and then even stratification by the subsites within the non-cardia. The first column summarizes the rates and the estimated annual percentage change for people less than 50 years of age. And as you can see, there is a significant increase 3% per year for non-cardia overall. And when we please focus on the blue font, the estimated annual percentage for fundus is about 3% per year for females, and interestingly for corpus is 3% per year for males and 6% per year for females. These are lower rates, but at this rate, as I'm going to present, this will impact the overall rates of gastric cancer. In order to understand the potential etiology of these unfavorable trends, we did a stratified analysis based on the prevalence of poverty using census data. And we stratify, and as you can see, the effect is stronger for groups with less than 10% poverty, which argue against the role of H. pylori explaining these unfavorable trends. We also did an stratification by race ethnicity, and as you can see, we see a significant increase in the rates for Hispanics, particularly females, but for non-Hispanic blacks and others, mainly representing Asians, we don't see that transition yet. As part of the analysis, we did some predictions, and to your left, we have the stratification by age and also by sex. The bottom of the figure represents the rates for males and females below 50 years of age. And as you can see, we study the data from 1995 to 2013. We see that women have already exceeded the risk of gastric cancer. And the projection is that this is continue to increase, to the point that, that the risk for females will be higher as compared to males. And for the older group, we see that for women, the rates have already plateaued, and for males, we see a deceleration in the decline of the rates. When we combine these two age groups, the projection suggests that by 2030, the male to female ratio, the excess of risk in males, we are not going to see that. The rates will be the same for male and females, and the rates are no longer declining. This is not happening just in the US. We have data from other developed countries. Here I am presenting some selected ones, Australia, Canada, Israel, Sweden, and the UK. And as you can see, we see an increase in the younger groups. And here we have a projection by 2035. This is data from Globocan, it's a collaboration with IARC. And we see a significant increase for people less than 50 years of age for the countries that I am listing here, including the US. We believe that this is just a change in the etiological fractions of the major risk factors for gastric cancer. So in the absence of H. pylori, these other risk factors may gain some space. And among those, we know the well-recognized effect of smoking and also salt consumption. Potentially, we could think that PPIs are also involved in these changes, changes in the microbiome related or unrelated to the use of antibiotics could be also playing a role, and also autoimmune gastritis. I'm going to address the data for smoking just to argue that smoking is not responsible for the unfavorable trends that we see. This is data from the US Health Interview Survey for the period 1998 to 2008. And as you can see, we have seen a consistent decline for smoking, which is very good. And we see that in all age groups. In terms of salt intake, this is particularly sodium. This is an interesting systematic analysis combining data from 24-hour urinary sodium and excretion and also dietary surveys for several countries, and they compare 1990 versus 2010. As you can see, all populations are consuming a lot of sodium, but higher consumptions are seen in Central Asia and the high income Asian Pacific, which somehow explain the high risk of gastric cancer in these populations. In the US, the arrow that I have there show that in the US we have a high consumption of sodium, but these numbers haven't changed for the between 1999 to 2010, and I have the estimates for both males and females. additional data from enhanced disease sodium intake in non-Hispanic whites by age and gender. And as you can see, these are mainly plateau. We are continue consuming a lot of sodium, but the trend hasn't changed over time. In terms of PPIs, we know that the consumption has dramatically increased in the last years in the US and other developed countries, and even in developing ones. We know that if H. pylori is present when PPIs are prescribed, we are going to see a transition from the anterior colonization to the proximal colonization in the beautiful way that Manuel presented to us in the previous session. We did an analysis in collaboration with some Danish investigators trying to see if we saw an excess in the risk of gastric cancer for tumors localized to the corpus. And this is important because in the corpus we have the parietal cells that are responsible for the excretion of acid and to maintain the low pH in the stomach. And as you can see, we have this represents, in one axis, we have the hazard ratios and hazard ratio, and in the other, we have the years since starting PPIs. And as you see, there is not an excess in the tumors localized to the corpus. I think that we need to keep an eye on this data to see the long-term effects of consumption of PPIs. As you well know, there is a parallel pathway to develop gastric cancer. So we have the well-described H. pylori-driven, but we have also the autoimmune gastritis pathway in which people develop antibodies, anti-parietal cells, and if the parietal cells are lost, you will enter in this in the chorea cascade, and then there is a variable progression to intestinal metaplasia, dysplasia, and cancer. We know well that there are many immune disorders that have dramatically increased since 1950, and these are Crohn's disease, diabetes, type 1, asthma, multiple sclerosis. So this argues towards the possibility of an increase in autoimmune gastritis, although we don't have data. These are data coming from a group in Karolinska showing that the prevalence of atrophic gastritis in the corpus have tripled in the between the period 1990 to 2009, particularly for the group 35 to 44. We know that we are highly exposed to antibiotics. This is just to show trends of, in the bottom, antibiotics received for treatment, and more importantly, the antibiotics that we receive through the food chain. And as you can see, there are dramatic increases, and we believe that this has an impact on our human bodies. Data on antibiotics are limited. These are one of the few examples from ENHANCE. This is a question about antibiotic exposure in the past 30 days, ENHANCE 1999 to 2012. As you can see, the trends are declining. So we start, for example, in males, the prevalence was 5.6% for the first period and 3.2% for the last period. So it seems that it has been declining. However, we see that there is an excess of use of antibiotics in females, and in terms of race ethnicity, we see a higher consumption in non-Hispanic whites. It will be interesting to try to document the use of antibiotics in other data sets. All of this argue towards the possibility of a disruption in the microbiome, and this is the theory of the disappearing microbiota proposed by Dr. Blaser. Unfortunately, new generations are less exposed to H. pylori and other microbes. We know that H. pylori has been with humans since humans left Africa. So we believe that potentially, you know, this coevolution, it is good, and maybe in the early years, H. pylori is good, but maybe in the adult life, there is basically a price to pay. We know that new generations are less exposed in terms of vertical and horizontal transmission because we are living in a very clean environment, and this may lead to an alteration and a proper maturation of the adaptive immune system. And just to summarize, the patterns of gastric cancer have been changing over time. We started with a classic pattern of tumors localized to the distal area of the stomach. This mainly affected Asians and old people, and they were mainly driven by Helicobacter pylori infection. In the 80s, 90s, we started to see an increase in the risk of tumors localized to the more proximal part of the stomach, and we saw that these trends mainly affected Caucasian, and this was mainly related to obesity and reflux. And now, and in the future, we are going to see a new pattern. This pattern is represented by tumors localized to the corpus of the stomach, affecting mainly Caucasians, and the role of H. pylori is still unclear. Maybe in the absence of H. pylori, other bacteria are taking advantage, and we know the mimicry effect of bacteria. We believe that this could also lead to autoimmunity, and so importantly, the no changes in the microbiome are particularly important for this future panel of gastric cancer. Additional studies need to be done in order to fully address the causes of these changes. Thank you so much for your attention. I want to acknowledge all my wonderful collaborators from NCI, Charles present here, our great collaborators from Denmark, and also, and of course, all the hard working people and in the cancer registries in the US, CDC and CIR. Thank you.